Hi everybody, welcome to my channel Arvind Educations. Thanks for watching my videos. For more information, please subscribe my channel Arvind Educations or Arvind Biology Classes. Today, I'm going to discuss about 10th Biology Diagram Based Questions Part 1. This video includes diagram based questions, experimental based questions, data analysis questions and their answers. So let us see first question. What is the aim of this experiment? To prove that carbon dioxide is essential for photosynthesis. Next question. What are the materials used in this experiment? Potted plant, glass jar, KOH, potassium hydroxide, rubber cork, iodine, watch glass, wax or vaseline. Next question. What is the chemical used in the bottle and why do we use it? KOH. It absorbs carbon dioxide present in the bottle. That's why we use KOH. Next question. What is the inference you draw from the experiment? We can conclude from this experiment that carbon dioxide is essential for photosynthesis. Next question. How are the apparatus arranged? Take a plant with long and narrow leaves. Take a wide mouthed glass jar. Take 10 ml of KOH into the jar before inserting the leaf. Insert half of the leaf into the bottle through a slit cork. Apply wax or vaseline. Then arrange the apparatus in the sunlight as shown in the diagram. Next question. After iodine test, which part of the leaf turns blue-black and why? The part of the leaf outside the jar turns blue-black because carbon dioxide is available for the part of the leaf which is outside the glass jar. Next question. Why do we need to discharge the plant before experiment? The starch present in the leaf may interfere with the experiment or interfere with the result. The starch present already may interfere with the experimental result. That's why we need to destarch the plant before doing experiment. Next question. What are the precautions to be taken in the experiment? 1. Handle the glass material carefully. 2. Leaf apex should not touch the alkali or KOH. 3. Wax or vaseline should be applied properly. 4. Splitted cork should be tightly fit to the mouth of the bottle. First question. What is the aim of this experiment? To prove that oxygen is released during photosynthesis. Next question. Why do we use hydrilla plant in the experiment? Because as we are showing the release of gas, so we are doing experiment on aquatic plants, any aquatic plant. Here we considered hydrilla plant. Next question. What is the gas collected in the test tube? The gas collected in the test tube is oxygen. Next question. How do you test the gas collected in the test tube? By introducing a burning splinter or incense stick, it burns more brightly. So the gas which permits things to burn more brightly is oxygen. So we can prove that the gas collected there is oxygen. Next question. What are the precautions to be taken in the experiment? First precaution, handle the glass material carefully. Second one, cut the hydrilla twigs slantingly in the water. Third, careful while inverting the test tube onto the funnel. Last question. Label any four parts in the diagram. Beaker, test tube, thistle funnel, hydrilla twigs, bubbles indicate gas. Next. First question here. What is the aim of this experiment? To prove that sunlight is essential for photosynthesis. Next question. Why should we cover the leaf with light screen or black paper to prevent the entry of sun rays onto the leaf? Next question. What inference you draw from the experiment? We can conclude from this experiment that sunlight is essential for photosynthesis. Next question. How do you test the presence of starch in leaf? Boil the leaf in water for 15 minutes. Then boil the leaf in the test tube containing alcohol on water bath for around 10 minutes. Wash the leaf and add freshly prepared iodine solution. If leaf turns blue-black, then the starch is present. If there is no color change, then starch is absent. Next question. Which part of the leaf turns blue-black? What about the remaining part? The part of the leaf exposed to sunlight through cut design turns blue-black. The remaining portion turns brown or no color change where we are using light screen. Last question. How do we de-starch the plant? By keeping the plant in dark room for 2 to 3 days. When we kept the plant in dark room for 2 to 3 days, the starch already present in the plant is utilized by plant for its survival, so we can de-starch the plant. Next. First question, what does the diagram indicate? It indicates peristaltic movements or movement of food or bolus through food pipe, esophagus, movement of food in esophagus. Next question. Name the part of the alimentary canal in the diagram that is esophagus or commonly considered as food pipe. Next question. Name the muscles responsible for movement of bolus. The longitudinal and circular muscles present in the wall of esophagus are responsible for peristaltic movements. Next question. What is the name of the movement shown in the diagram? That is peristalsis, peristaltic movement. Next, name the sphincter through which bolus enters the stomach, that is cardiac sphincter. Cardiac sphincter present between esophagus and upper part of the stomach, that is cardiac stomach, through which bolus enters from esophagus into stomach. Next. Next. What is the main role of epiglottis? Epiglottis prevents entry of food into trachea, windpipe. Next question. Label the parts in the diagram. Palate bone, parotid gland, sublingual gland, submaxillary or submandibular gland. Next question. Why are we advised not to talk while eating? Due to improper closure of glottis and epiglottis, food may enter into trachea and leads to choking, which causes coughing and breathing problems. That's why we are advised not to talk while eating. Next question. Name the enzyme produced by salivary glands. Salivary glands produce saliva. Saliva consists of only one enzyme, that is salivary amylase or thiolin. Next question. Name the bone which separates nasal and oral cavity, that is bony palate or palate bone. Palate bone separates nasal cavity and oral cavity. Next question. Name the three salivary glands and their locations. We human beings possess three pairs of salivary glands: parotid gland, sublingual gland, submaxillary or submandibular gland. Parotid gland present below the ear, sublingual gland present below the tongue, submaxillary or submandibular gland present near the joint of both the jaws. Next question. Name the food substrate partially digested in the mouth. Carbohydrates are partially digested in the mouth. Carbohydrates are converted into dextrins or disaccharides with the help of salivary amylase or thiolin. Next. What does this experiment indicate, it indicates that during breathing out, carbon dioxide is evolved. Next question. Which gas turns lime water milky? Carbon dioxide turns lime water milky. Next question. Which gas do you think might be present in greater quantities in the air we breathe out as compared to air around us? That is carbon dioxide. Next, what does this diagram indicate? This diagram indicates nutrition in amoeba. Next, how is the food taken by the organism? Amoeba takes in food by using temporary finger-like extensions or pseudopodia, which fuse over the food particle taken inside. Digestive enzymes are secreted and food material is completely digested and absorbed into the cytoplasm of amoeba. Next, what are the structures that help in nutrition of this organism? Pseudopodia. Next, name the organism depicted in the diagram. Amoeba. Here, first question. Label the parts 1, 2 and 3. 1 is liver, 2 stomach, 3 pancreas. What is the juice secreted by 1? As 1 is liver, liver is producing bile juice. Next question. What are the types of cells present in pancreas? Pancreas possess both exocrine and endocrine cells. Exocrine cells of pancreas are called acinar cells or cells of acini, and endocrine cells are called islets of Langerhans. Next question. Name the hormones produced by pancreas. Pancreas secreting 3 hormones: insulin, glucagon and somatostatin. Next, name the enzymes produced by pancreas. Pancreas produce pancreatic juice. It includes trypsinogen, pancreatic amylase, also called as amylapsin, and pancreatic lipase. Trypsinogen is activated into trypsin with the help of chymotrypsin, which acts on proteins. Pancreatic amylase acts on carbohydrates. Pancreatic lipase acts on emulsified fats. Next, which gland is considered as mixed gland? Why it is called so? Pancreas is called mixed gland because it is both exocrine and endocrine in nature. Pancreas is made up of both exocrine and endocrine cells. That is why pancreas is considered as mixed gland. Name the digestive juice which do not possess enzymes. That is only one, that is bile juice. Bile juice produced by liver do not possess any enzymes. Just bile juice consists of bile salts and bile pigments. Here, first question. What process does this picture depict? It shows the process of exchange of gases between alveolus and blood capillary. Name the gas entering the alveolus, that is carbon dioxide. From blood capillary, carbon dioxide enters into alveolus. Next, identify the gas entering into RBC of capillaries, that is oxygen. From alveolus, oxygen enters into blood capillary. Next, label the parts 1, 2, 3 and 4. 1 is carbon dioxide, that is diffusing from capillary into alveolus. 2 is oxygen, that is diffusing from alveolus into blood capillary, RBC. Third is wall of capillary. Fourth is wall of alveolus. Next question. Name the physiological process involved in exchange of gases. The physiological process which is involved here is diffusion. Based on diffusion, the oxygen present in alveolus enters into blood capillary, and based on the same diffusion, carbon dioxide present in the blood capillary diffused into alveoli. Next, do cells of alveoli or lungs also require oxygen to carry out cellular respiration? Why or why not? Yes, cells of alveoli or lungs also require oxygen to carry out cellular respiration because they too need energy to work, so they consume oxygen for cellular respiration. Next, what was the concentration of lactic acid in the blood to start with? Here on one axis, concentration of lactic acid in blood milligram per cubic centimeter is shown. On the other axis, time in minutes is indicated. So first question, what was the concentration of lactic acid in the blood to start with? It is around 20%. Second question, what was the greatest concentration reached during the experiment? It is crossing 100, it may be around 102 or 103. Next, if the trend between points C and D were to continue at the same rate, how long might it take for the original lactic acid level to be reached again? If the trend between C and D is continued little more, then it may take approximately up to 70 minutes, because around 60 minutes it is showing around 40%. So if you just extend the same line towards your right side, then it may reach its 20% initial level around up to 70 minutes time. Last question, what does high level of lactic acid indicate about condition of respiration? Here, accumulation of lactic acid indicates vigorous exercise during which glucose is oxidized anaerobically due to oxygen depth. After some time, lactic acid is removed when oxygen depth is cleared. That means when glucose is anaerobically respired, here lactic acid is accumulated. So when sufficient oxygen, whenever sufficient oxygen is supplied, again that lactic acid is converted into carbon dioxide and water, so the lactic acid is removed from the cells. Here first question, what is the aim of the experiment? To prove production of heat and carbon dioxide under anaerobic conditions, absence of oxygen. Label the parts in the diagram. From left side, yeast in boiled and cooled glucose, then liquid paraffin, then thermometer, then lime water, two delivery tubes, and two hold rubber cork. Next, why do we pour liquid paraffin wax on glucose solution with yeast? Just to cut off the supply of oxygen from the air to boiled and cooled glucose solution, because we are doing this experiment in anaerobic conditions. To stop the supply of oxygen, we pour liquid paraffin wax on the glucose solution. Next question, what change do you observe in the thermometer? Definitely, mercury levels in the thermometer slowly rises. Next question, why do we use diazine green in the experiment? Diazine green, also called as Janus green B. Here, diazine green or Janus green B is added to the solution before liquid paraffin wax is poured to the test tube, whether oxygen is completely removed or not. The blue dye here turns pink if oxygen is present. If the solution turns pink color, then still oxygen is present. If the solution remains blue color, then oxygen is absent. That means experimental setup is perfectly in anaerobic conditions to carry on further experiment. Okay, I'll repeat. Diazine green or Janus green B is added to the solution before liquid paraffin wax is poured to the test whether oxygen is completely removed or not. The blue dye turns pink if oxygen is present. If oxygen is absent, it remains in blue color. Last question. How do you confirm the release of carbon dioxide? Lime water turns milky white. First question, is there any increase in temperature? Yes, the mercury column in thermometer raises slowly. Next question, does the temperature increase steadily or does it abruptly increase at a time of the day? It increases steadily. Next question, where does the heat come from? Heat comes from the sprouted seeds as they are germinated or exhibiting metabolic activities by cellular oxidation. When they are exhibiting metabolic activities, automatically heat is released. Next question, what is the aim of the experiment? To show that heat is evolved during respiration. Next, why do you use sprouts only in the experiment? We are using sprouts to exhibit more metabolism, means germinating seeds here. We can also do the same experiment with dry seeds, but rate of metabolism is very less, so heat production is very less, so we need to wait for result for more time. That's why we are using here germinating seeds or sprouts. Next, what is the reason for rise in temperature? Due to cellular oxidation by sprouts or germinating seeds, some amount of energy is released in the form of heat. So that heat is shown in the rays of mercury column in the thermometer. Label the parts in the diagram. Thermometer, flask, germinating seeds or sprouts, then one hold rubber cork. Here, first question, identify the diagram. This particular diagram indicates lenticels on the stem. Where do you find such structures? These structures, lenticels, are found on the surface of stems and on the surface of older roots also. So they are seen on the surface of stems and on the surface of older roots. How do they resemble stomata? Like stomata, lenticels also helps in respiration and transpiration, but lenticels are the permanent openings, whereas stomata can be regulated. Means opening and closing of stomata can be observed, but lenticels are permanent openings. Last question, what is the function of these structures? These structures means lenticels, they helps in respiration and transpiration. Your first question, what do you call these plants growing in saline water logged conditions? Give example. The plants which are growing in saline water logged conditions are called mangroves. The picture shows mangroves. Example, Rhizophora and Nipa. Rhizophora and Nipa. Second question, what are these peg-like structures produced from roots of these plants? These are called aerial roots. These are aerial roots with a hollow stem. Next, why do the trees develop such negatively geotrophic roots? Because air transport is more difficult for trees and not many survive with their roots permanently in water. So mangrove trees forms aerial roots above the soil surface and takes in oxygen through these roots. As roots are growing above the surface of the soil, they are exhibiting negative geotropism. Here, geotropic movement means growth of the plant towards the source of gravity or soil. Generally, roots exhibit positive geotropism and shoot exhibit negative geotropism. Here, as roots are growing above the soil surface, that's why they are exhibiting negative geotropism. Now, what does a doctor test by holding your wrist? Doctor, by holding your wrist, test our pulse rate. Next question. What is the relation between heartbeat and pulse rate? Heartbeat, pulse rate, both are similar, both are equal. Your pulse rate is your heart rate. Next. Is pulse rate same as heartbeat? Yes, because your pulse is equal to your heart rate. Last question. What happens to pulse rate when you jog? Is it the same when you are at rest? When an individual is jogging, generally pulse rate increases. And pulse rates vary from person to person. Your pulse is lower when you are at rest. Thank you. Thank you for watching my videos. For more updates, please subscribe my channel, Arvind Biology Classes or Arvind Educations. Thank you.